In this episode, let's take a look at growing nonlinear crystals that can convert laser light into different colors using a process known as second harmonic generation. These are the same crystals that are used in the National Ignition Facility, a laser-driven nuclear fusion experiment. Second harmonic generation, also called frequency doubling, is a nonlinear optical phenomenon in which two photons of the same frequency interact inside of a nonlinear material and are combined to generate a new photon with twice the energy of the initial photons. In this way, infrared light can be converted into green light, as you can see here. I have a video demonstrating how this phenomenon works that I'll link in down below, so be sure to subscribe and check it out. Second harmonic generation was first demonstrated by Peter Franken et al. In 1961 following the invention of the laser, which created the required high-intensity coherent light. They focused a 3-joule ruby laser with a wavelength of 694 nanometers into a quartz crystal that produced second harmonic UV light at 347 nanometers. Famously, when published in the journal Physical Review Letters, the copy editor actually mistook the dim spot at 347 nanometers on the photographic paper as a speck of dirt and removed it from the publication. Materials exhibiting large nonlinear effects are normally quite exotic, such as the potassium titanyl phosphate crystals used in the manufacture of green laser pointers. Although the cost of such crystals has come down due to mass production, large crystals and crystals for other wavelengths are still very expensive. Although nonlinear crystals can be prohibitively expensive to manufacture, considerable research has been conducted into growing them at large scale and inexpensively, especially for large systems. One such system is the National Ignition Facility. This is a laser-based inertial confinement fusion research device located at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory in the United States. It is the largest and most complex laser system in existence, with over 7,000 meter scale optics and 26,000 smaller ones. The facility itself takes up the space of 3 football fields and can deliver up to 2 million joules of ultraviolet light and 500 terawatts of peak power into a fusion target the size of a pencil eraser. This is called a Hohlraum. This generates the extreme pressures and temperatures necessary to achieve nuclear fusion. It achieved the first instance of scientific breakeven controlled fusion in an experiment on December 5th, 2022, with an energy gain factor of 1.5. Note that this does not factor in the actual power consumption of the facility, an important omission by the popular press. Nonetheless, this is a huge achievement, and I will link in their channel down below. Given the epic scale of this laser system, extremely large optics are required, and one of the requirements of fusion is that high-energy UV light is delivered to the target. To achieve this, the researchers at the National Ignition Facility have done considerable work in growing very large, inexpensive nonlinear crystals to convert the infrared 1053 nanometer laser light into ultraviolet 351 nanometer laser light. The crystals that the National Ignition Facility grows are manufactured from potassium dihydrogen phosphate. This is ordinary fertilizer, though for UV generation they use deuterated potassium dihydrogen phosphate. Although not as efficient as other nonlinear materials, these crystals can be grown on a huge scale, with growth rates as high as 50 millimeters per day in sizes up to 800 pounds for a single crystal. Potassium dihydrogen phosphate is also a highly versatile material which can be cut along various planes and can yield optics for Pockels cells, second harmonic generation crystals, and third harmonic generation crystals. Industrially, potassium dihydrogen phosphate can be grown at high speed using a controlled cooling regime using a rotary crystallizer. This may well be a topic of a future video. Potassium dihydrogen phosphate can, however, be grown slowly but very easily with simple materials at home. These are grown using a series of simple steps. 200 mL of boiling distilled water is added to a beaker, to which 50 grams of potassium dihydrogen phosphate is added and stirred until it's dissolved. The solution is then allowed to cool slowly to room temperature overnight. This actually achieves two goals. Some potassium dihydrogen phosphate will crystallize out in the bottom of the beaker that may yield seed crystals. And secondly, the solution that we're left with is guaranteed to be supersaturated with potassium dihydrogen phosphate ready for growing. The solution is then poured off into a second beaker that will be used to grow the crystal. Some solution is also poured into a watch glass to grow big seeds. A nice seed crystal is then selected, and to this I've glued a short piece of fishing line. The best way to do this is to dip one end of the line into a small drop of superglue and rest the line on the crystal. After that, all that is needed is to hang the crystal in the solution and wait. It is important to keep dust out, so a cover should be placed over the beaker that allows water vapor to escape but keeps dust out of the way. On at least one occasion when I was growing this, the temperature actually spiked in the room and this caused the crystal to start dissolving, so you do need a nice stable room temperature to grow good crystals. I've set up several of these now so I can experiment more with this material. Here is the final crystal. I'm wearing gloves because potassium dihydrogen phosphate is sensitive to moisture. I also had to pull this out early because of the hot weather that we've had here recently. This weighs in at about 2.8 grams and as we can see it's got a significant length. Most of this is very clear, although the surfaces are not perfectly flat because of temperature fluctuations during growing. It should be possible to polish these imperfections out and even cut the crystals as well, and this will be a topic of a future video, so be sure to subscribe. There's enough of a clear aperture that it should be possible to demonstrate second harmonic generation with this. All we have to do is place the crystal in the beam path at the correct angle. For this experiment, I have a Two Trees 1064 nanometer pulse laser producing 89 microjoules in 5 nanoseconds. This gives us a peak power of around about 17 kilowatts per pulse, although the average power is about 2 watts or so. Of course, for an experiment like this, we do require the all-important safety glasses. To the front of the laser, I've attached a homemade collimator, as the laser is actually focused to a point for laser engraving. I've actually made several of these for different purposes on the lathe. The one fitted produces a nice tight 1 mm wide beam. In the beam path, I have an IR pass filter, which cuts off the pilot light from the laser itself. And in front of that, I have a half wave plate so I can rotate the polarization of the beam and match it to the crystal. The crystal is mounted on a rotary stage. Before I get to the large crystal, I'll place some seed crystals into the beam path so you can see what happens. We can see that the laser is on by using the IR detector card. If I just dump some crystals into the beam path, we should see little green flashes already. And as I begin to rotate the stage, once the angles are correct, we get little tiny green flashes of second harmonic light. Very, very nice. We'll keep going and see what else happens. Oh, there was a bright flash there. Look at that. Absolutely spectacular. This is amazing. Even with quite poor crystals, we're getting second harmonic generation. I've mounted the large crystal in the beam path. As we saw earlier, we need to set the angle of the crystal to 41.1 degrees with respect to the IR beam. As I rotate the crystal in the path, a brilliant green beam emerges. You can see that the beam is quite dirty as this is a raw, unpolished crystal, but at some point I'm going to attempt to cut and polish these crystals to see if it's possible to make Pockel cells and maybe even achieve third harmonic generation at home. Here is a smaller but cleaner crystal of potassium dihydrogen phosphate, producing a really beautiful clean green beam. If you want to see more of this kind of content, don't forget to hit subscribe and turn on notifications so that you don't miss new videos. This episode is supported by my awesome Patreons and channel donators, and of course the encouragement and questions from subscribers. I really appreciate your support.